Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen. 2 Corinthians, 12th chapter. We want to talk about the sufficient grace of God tonight. Amen.
2 Corinthians 1.
Chapter 12, we'll start about verse 7. The key verse is going to be verse 9, but we're going to read. When you're there, say amen.
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 Amen. All right, it says.
Wait a minute. You didn't say amen, did you?
No, we did not hear you, First Lady.
Ah.
Brother Larry, see what you did? It's Texas.
Did my turn mine off?
It's Texas.
I'll be having people calling me.
That's so crazy.
Most of the telemarketers calling on the cell phone now.
Okay.
You have won a 3-day cruise to the Bahamas.
Yeah, yay.
All right, it says this, Paul's writing, and lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations that was given to me, a thorn in the flesh. The messenger of Satan to buffet me. Lest I should be exalted above measure. Now, this is an extraordinary thing Paul's saying here, because God gave Paul such profound revelation of heaven, of the Word of God, that, man, if anybody could have got the big head, Paul could have got the big head. But a messenger of Satan was assigned to him as a thorn in the flesh. Now, Paul used a thorn in the flesh because if you ever stepped on a thorn, mm-hmm. I have.
Yeah.
I mean, man, that is I don't know what a snake bite feels like, and I hope I never do, but I have stepped on a thorn. It bruises you. It hurts. It's a throbbing pain that constantly makes you aware every time you put your foot down. So this messenger was given and sent to Paul to buffet him, to keep him humble, and the fact that Paul had to suffer as you and I suffer. Paul did not escape hardships, pain, the perplexities of life. He hungered, he thirsted. There were many times they were weary. He was shipwrecked. He was bitten by a snake. He was stoned. He was beaten. And eventually he lost his life by being beheaded. But because of the extraordinary relationship he had with God, God chose Paul as he chooses each and every one. God has not chosen me to pastor a mega church. He hasn't chosen me to be an inner city pastor. He has chosen me to do what I'm doing as he chose others to do what they're doing. Why? Because inbred in us, birthed in us, is the ability to do things other people can't do.
Amen.
That's why God gave Paul such magnificent revelation. Paul was a smart man in the natural. You know, he understood different languages. He was brought up in some of the Harvard or the Yale universities of his time. And so as Paul was smart naturally, God took that and knocked him down on the road of Damascus, and he used it supernaturally. But God foreknew that someone, he had to use the human agent in order to write the Word of God. If God relied upon me to write the word, man, we'd be in bad shape. But God knows there's an intellectual, a knowledge, an understanding, a talent, a gifting that's birthed inside that will carry us to do what God's called us to do. But whatever we do for God's important. Be it sweeping the floors and doing menial tasks, if it's seeking God and lifting Him up and winning souls, it is a worthy cause. For this thing I besought the Lord three times, that it may depart from Him. How many times have you gone through something and you've asked God to deliver you from it, but He has yet to deliver you from it? I'm going through some stuff right now. And I have prayed, and I have prayed, and I have fasted, and I've read the ten steps to this, and the three steps to that, and take the key and unlock this, and do that, and I'm still in this place where there's a humbling of God that God is teaching us. As He said unto Paul, He said, God said unto me, Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. In our walk with God, in our development, in our growth, we try many things, but it's always the grace of God.
Amen.
That's sufficient.
Amen.
Through storms, through tribulations, through the longevity of a trial, be it mental, physical, financial, whatever it may be, you're trying to get yourself out of it. And God's saying, hey, Mike, my grace is sufficient. Amen. Quit trying to figure it out.
Amen. Amen.
Quit sitting there with pencil in hand, figuring this and figuring that, and moving this and moving that, selling this and doing that.
Come on.
Leave it alone.
Come on.
My grace is sufficient for you. That thorn in the flesh that Paul suffered, it might be a physical element that you're dealing with. It might be a marital element. It might be a child. It might be whatever. Unemployment.
Come on.
But until we depend upon the grace of God, all that we're doing is in vain.
That's right. That's right.
Because let me something. One thing I have learned in my life is that if God's trying to teach me a lesson, there's nothing I'm going to do to change God's mind except yield to Him.
That's it.
It takes you quite a while to do that. Well, I went going around that mountain. He said, how long are you going to keep going around that mountain? I mean, think about it, church. Look what we have created and done trying to force God's hand to do something to get out of a test. That God is allowing us to go through so He can show us and reveal to us His grace. I've got your back. I'm going to carry you through this. Yes, the night's dark. The days are long. It's a heavy burden to carry. But I'm trying to teach you something. That my grace is sufficient. Now listen to this. For my grace is sufficient. The word sufficient means enough. Adequate. It's all we need. Don't need any more. God's got it. He's given it to us. If we will embrace it. Listen to this. What is the grace of God? Everybody pops in their head, the unmerited favor of God. That's it. But listen to this. God's grace is comprehensive and complete. It saves, it sanctifies, it rescues, restores, and it transforms us from hell as hell-bound sinners to be holy, living saints of God.
Amen. Amen.
That's the grace of God. And just as it was the Lord's supernatural and infinite grace that saved us, it is His supernatural, infinite grace that keeps us. It's God that's keeping me together.
Amen. That's good. Amen.
It's God's grace keeping me from blowing my mind, brain out. It's God's grace that keeps me in the ship. You remember when Paul told the captain of the ship that we're going to go through some bad stuff, but to stay in the ship, that's God's grace. Mm-hmm. Now, what they did in that storm is what we often do when we're going through a storm. Rather than trusting God to get us through by His grace, we're throwing stuff overboard. Mm-hmm. We're trying to make something out. Trying to lighten the load. We'll go down to a loan company and pay 37% interest on a $1,000 note just to get by. I've been there, done it. I have got some Ishmaels I have birthed. Because God was trying to teach me that my grace is sufficient for you.
Come on, Pastor. Come on.
So if my grace, my love, my compassion, my presence is good enough, why, and you trust me, and you have my word, then why are you panicking?
Yeah. Mm.
If you believe that I'll never leave you nor forsake, if you believe that I'll make a way where there seemeth to be no way, if you believe my grace is sufficient, why are you doing all this other stuff trying to make it happen?
Hallelujah.
Paul said, deliver me of this thorn in the flesh. Deliver me of this backache. Deliver me of this arthritis. Deliver me, God. God said, Paul, wait a minute. My grace is sufficient. Now, this is what blew my mind when I really started studying this. For it says, my strength. Whose strength?
His
strength. God's strength.
Amen.
God's strength, and this is what came to me, is made what?
Perfect.
In weakness.
In weakness.
What?
Weakness.
So when you're weak, He's strong.
Strong in God.
Hey, that's when you're
strong. I wrote this down. Listen to this.
Come on.
The weaker you are, the stronger grace is.
That's it. That's it.
When you're absolutely depleted of your resources,
that's it.
God's grace is sufficient.
Amen.
God, let me tell you something, church. If God will send an angel, literally, not symbolically, not a story or a theory or a myth. He literally sent a physical angel to build a fire and to put food on it and cook it for the man of God. How much more will God do for us? We pray for faith, but yet we don't want to go through the storm that makes our faith stronger. And I know there's a lot of trials. I mean, we've suffered the loss of a child. That was painful. But you know, the greatest trial that I have is financial. Trusting God for my bread and water.
Amen.
Because your faith is bold when you've got money in the bank and everything's going fine. But when
No income,
and you're praying it in.
That's right.
Amen. I had a man the other night. We went out and ate with him. He pulled. I didn't tell Sister Bassemier about this, but I put it in the bank. Pulled out, wadded up a little, and reached down, and I one of them Pentecostal handshakes. And I took it and I just stuck it in my pocket, and I got outside. It was a $100 bill. That's what we bought groceries with today, sister. And $133 at Walmart was well taken care of. And God's grace is sufficient. But when you're, maybe y'all don't have done what I've done in the past, and I thank God I don't do it anymore. But I would quote scriptures. God's my supplier. He'll make a way where there seemeth to be no way. and I'm looking in the shed for something to sell.
We have took many tests over and over and over, and over before and he over. Finally just got it.
So, why? Because God was trying to teach me about grace. But you know, I wasn't being taught that. I wasn't being taught about the sufficiency of God's grace. That God's grace alone is enough for me. And this is what God's trying to teach us individually, and this is what he's trying to teach us corporately. Because I hear sometimes the panic in the voices of God's people. I hear that uncertain sound. Man, what are we going to do? How are we going to make it? Well, you know. And all the time, God's trying to teach us about his strength. Listen, God's grace is more than just a word or a concept. More than the manner in which God deals with us. As in, I'm saved by grace and everything I do is by grace. Which it is. It's more than that. It is his merciful, enabling help, his ongoing empowerment, his continual working on our behalf. When we're sleeping, God's working. God's always moving, orchestrating things for our behalf. But what happens is when that messenger that comes to buffet us, he buffet us, whatever, ticks me off, aggravates me. When he comes to do that, he is trying to get us distracted from the grace of God.
That's right.
And he tried to get us impatient. He said, Paul, you better do something. You better make it happen. You better get out there and work four jobs. You got to make it happen. One of the things I've learned in life, and it is a hard lesson to learn, is when Brother Gil's going through something, and I'm compassionate, and I want to help him out, and God said, leave him alone.
That's it.
Because I'm trying to teach him something, and you're trying to get him out what I'm trying to teach him.
Wow.
That's a hard lesson to learn.
Wow.
You see, God loves us so much, he wants to do it. And he wants us to learn these lessons that you can't bail everybody out. You can't help Amen. Everybody out. Amen. You can love them, you can pray for them, but it's God's business to reveal his grace
Hallelujah.
In a time of need to that person.
Hallelujah.
And if we bail them out of it, hey, you know what? That's just sending them back around the mountain again. And that's hard.
Yep, it is.
Especially with one of your kids. Or your neighbor. Listen to this. Grace, it speaks of the Lord's past, present, and future action, expressing what Jesus does for us and not just what he did for us. What not only what he did yesterday, but what he's doing today and what he's going to do tomorrow.
Amen. Amen.
My grace is sufficient. You see, here's something about grace that nobody ever taught me. But I had to learn it OJT.
On the job training.
On the job training.
We all learn that.
Because every time I ask somebody about grace, oh, brother, it's just the unmerited favor of God.
Uh-huh. Repeating what the preacher said.
The unmerited favor of God. Okay, well, what is grace? The unmerited favor of God. You know, I never looked that up.
That's amazing.
Yeah. And just till recently. And it is the unmerited favor of God. But it's more. It's not just God's grace for us in salvation. It's God's grace to carry us through life.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
It was God's grace that was there with me and Sister Bassemier standing at that hospital when we saw our daughter laid there on that gurney. Gone on to be with the Lord. It was God's grace that he carried us literally when all she was making was $35 a week babysitting and I couldn't pay to get a job. I put in applications until I was sick of putting in applications. And God said, Mike, there's a lesson about my grace I want you to learn, and there ain't nothing you're going to do to get out of this, so you might as well learn or burn. And what we try to do in America is because we're so high-tech now, so impatient now, so in a hurry now, so want it right now, today, we don't want to wait tomorrow or next week, so we're not really learning the true benefits of God's grace.
Amen.
Charge.
I had to put my old credit card in my desk drawer. You know why? Don't tell nobody, sis. But the truth of the fact of the matter is, I was impatient trying to make something happen. Where God said, Mike, if you'll pray about this and give me time to work it out.
Call that the pursuit of happiness. Huh?
Come on. And have the junk that we think that we gotta have, we don't really need any.
Amen. 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 Amen.
You know how many clothes? Look, I'm talking about the grace of God here.
Yes, that's it.
I got a closet full of clothes that ain't fit. And we live over here, and we don't run out of room for clothes.
Hmm. Wow.
And I got that many clothes that ain't fit that I don't even wear. Why? Because we think that we've got to have stuff. I read the other day on Facebook in Japan, I forgot what it's called, but there was a word they used, that families now are not buying any more than 3 shirts, like a couple pair of pants. They don't have no more than 2 plates in their house, 2 glasses in their house. They don't have, they have cut back and got rid of stuff because why do I need 15 white shirts in my closet?
That's right.
And 4 blue ones. And 10 pair of shoes. But because of the world that we live in and the programs that we get over television,
lust of the flesh,
that we got to run out and buy. And then when we get that credit card bill, and we're praying, oh Lord, I'm already maxed out, and I got a $125 basic payment note to make. That's a minimum payment. I ain't getting a little extra. That's a minimum. And you're praying, oh God, I need a miracle. God said, I didn't tell you to go to stage. What my will that you went to JCPenney or Kohl's? And now we're praying for the grace of God. Ain't it true?
Yeah, it's true. Come get me out of my bed.
Come get me out of this, God.
That's true.
Oh Lord, I got a thorn in the flesh. Every month it comes to me, Lord. Oh God, get that thorn out of me. God said, my grace. You know what the Lord told me? Well, I felt the Lord tell me. It's called the pray and pay plan.
Uh-huh. Please.
Now God can give us a lot of excess, Brother Gil, to help us out. If he wanted to do that. But he said, I'm gonna teach you a lesson. Why? Because he said, my grace is sufficient for you, and my strength is made perfect in your weakness.
Amen.
Now, as expressed by A.M. Hunter, said this, grace means primarily the free, forgiving love of God in Christ to sinners and the operation of that love in the lives of Christians. Grace is God's love.
Amen.
Grace is God's compassionate love toward us. It's not a force. It's not a feeling. Grace is God expressing His love to us and His sufficiency that, hey, look, I got your back. You know what I love about God? Even in self-inflicted wounds, He loves me enough that He helps me out.
Amen. Amen.
Even when I knew I deliberately done it, and I birthed that Ishmael, God said, Mike, I love you. I'm going to help you out.
Amen.
Now, I'm not going to get you out of it, but I'm going to help you through it. I'm not going to get you out of the storm, but I'm going to be with you in the storm. So I'm going to hold you together so you don't panic. I'm going to hold you together, and I'm going to make provision for you that you'll know that it's me that's given it. Why? Because God wants us to understand, especially now in this generation of materialistic value. Everything's materialism.
Yep, that's it.
That God's grace is made perfect. Perfection. No mistakes. No flaws. No bumps in the road. Made perfect in my weakness. For when I am weak, I'm strong. When I'm heavy and downcast, He's my love. He's my paraclete.
Paracletos.
Listen to this. God's grace is God's presence, favor, and power. Think about that. God's complete. God's grace is His presence and His power. His love. Toward us. That when I go through the storms of life, when I go through and Satan is there buffeting me, when he's there not only financially, but when he's there trying to hit me in my body, when he's trying there tormenting me in my mind. I'm going to say something, and this is not boasting, but if you don't think Satan rips up a preacher's mind, you ought to try pastoring a while.
Come on.
You ought to get some of the phone calls at 3 o'clock in the morning that I get.
Come on.
With people in desperation. And they need the answer now.
Yep.
Not, hey, give me 15 minutes and I'll call you back. No, they're desperate. They got the gun cocked. This ain't playing around stuff. This ain't give me 21 days and let me fast about. No, they need an answer. They need an encouraging word. They need the grace of God to flow through you to touch them. But if I'm disconnected with God and I'm not praying and studying and seeking God, then His grace is bottled up in the atmosphere of this world. Because my mind's so caught up in this and that and the other that I'm not even thinking about God. And the enemy loves it. Because if he can keep me from being distracted, if he can keep me distracted and busy doing even church stuff.
Right.
But stay out of that word. Stay out of the prayer closet. Stay out of that communion and intimacy with God. Then when that phone call comes, I'm empty. I'm dry.
Yeah.
And I learned this lesson one time. And I wish I could go back and undo it because I've made mistakes. And there was a lady one time, I can't remember her name, but we see her sometimes at Walmart and they met. Let me tell you, it was after church one day, and I'm going to say this and I'll close. I was exhausted. I mean, it had been one of those weekends. And this lady was telling me some serious stuff, and I wasn't no more paying attention to her. You know what we do? Yeah, sure, absolutely, yeah. And we were standing there in Walmart line, and she was telling her heart was being poured out, and Linda was standing with me, yes, ma'am, yeah. And then she asked me a question, because I wasn't paying attention to what she was talking about. My mind was somewhere else. I gave an answer that wasn't very pleasing. And that woman got ticked, son. I mean, she royally got ticked off right there in Walmart. You see, this is what the devil does when he gets you distracted. God help us when we give wrong advice in a hurried moment. When we're so depleted of God's word and dry that we give an opinion rather than inspiration. And we do it all the time. Because we're absent of God's word, because if you don't put nothing in, you can't give nothing out.
That's it.
Hallelujah.
And so when we're not putting the word of God in us, when we're not praying and seasoning that word through prayer and praise and worship, then when Selena will call me, or Brother Gill will call me, anybody, Sister Helen will call me, anybody could call me with a serious need, but if I'm not where I need to be with God, how can I give you the adequate answer that you need that will inspire you and encourage you and bless you? We cannot give people what we don't have. If you needed $1,000 right now, I can't give it to you. Anybody feel the other Lord? Lord speaking to anyone in service tonight. I feel a prophet. There's some prophets out there who do that to you now. Oh, I believe there's somebody in here. Lord, deal with them. Give me $1,000 tonight. Man, I need it. I need it. His grace is all we need. Let me tell you this story, and I'm going to close. Ten after, and I'll close my Bible. It don't matter. But, this is a true story, and some of y'all heard me tell it, but let me tell you about the grace of God. This was several years ago, and I had lost my job, and we were starving to death as an evangelist, and I didn't have a church to pastor. So we were buying groceries on a credit card. That's how bad it was. Our phone got disconnected. And you asked Sister Bassemier, I am a stickler about paying my bills. And it aggravates me. I mean, it royally ticks me off when I don't have the money to pay my bills. But God was teaching me about His sufficient grace, and I didn't know it. I was looking at the problem. I was looking at the phone disconnected. I was looking at the fact that I didn't have money in my pocket to even carry her to McDonald's and buy a $3 hamburger. That's how broke we were. So you know what I did? I went down that little old blacktop road. I started praying. And I started reminding God of what His word says. And I wasn't mad. I was just praying. And in that course of prayer, God brought and quickened into my spirit, and I believe it's in 1 Kings, about the four lepers who were outside the gate, and they were starving to death. There was a famine in the land. And I believe the Syrian army was inside the camp, and they smelled the aroma of hamburgers cooking, T-bone steaks. They heard the laughter. Man, people were drinking and having a good time. And they saw the campfire glittering, and they were sitting outside the gate. And one of them said, look, maybe we ought to go in and ask the Syrians, a soldier, for some, maybe they'll give us some molded bread and a cup of water to drink. And the other friend of his said, look, man, we do that, they're going to kill us. And his friend said, what difference does it make? We're dying anyway. So they said, okay, let us go. You know what God did? Man, they started walking. And their footsteps turned into amplifications. And it sounded like horses and chariots.
Yeah.
It sounded like an army was coming. And it was just four lepers just walking down, just carrying on. They weren't stomping their feet. They were just, but God took those footsteps, amplified it to where it would make them sound. You know what them Syrian soldiers did? Honey, they ran. They left their cloaks. They left their swords. They left their spears. They left the hamburgers on the grill. They left the coffee pot percolating. They left the T-bone steaks. They left everything. They left their wallets. They left all their money. And when these lepers walked in, man, they looked around. Where'd everybody go? And they went in and they pigged out. They ate until they couldn't eat no more. They got them old raggedy, stinky clothes off and put clothes on, and they gathered up stuff and took it and hid it. But they felt so bad of all the stuff that they accumulated and all the stuff that was left over, they sent a messenger to tell the king that the Syrian army's left and they got all this stuff down here for them to take. I went to the house. I told Sister Bassemier, I said, let's go. She said, where are we going? I said, I'm going to Peach Pharmacy and I'm going to pay our phone bill. And then I said, we're going to Walmart and buy a bill of groceries.
I said, what'd you do, rob the bank?
I said, what'd you do? I said, nope. I said, God's going to provide for us. I had $25 to my name in my account. I wrote over $400 of that day in checks. A friend of mine, a minister friend, had asked me to come and paint his house, which took maybe 2 days at the max to do the trim work on his house, and I was going to get paid for that. So while I'm over there waiting, and I'm thinking in my mind, okay, well, if I hurry up and finish this paint job, he'll pay me so I can rush to the bank and I can put the money in the bank before the check clears. And we're slick, ain't we? I mean, man, we're slick, boy. We think we got it all figured out. And so in the meantime, I leave. This was Monday, Tuesday. On a Tuesday, I finished up the job on the Wednesday. So this was a Tuesday. I went home. And at that time, we had a post office box in Amia. And I walked into the post office, and there was this brown bubble envelope from Daystar Ministry. And I'm thinking, who's Daystar Ministry? I had never heard of Daystar Ministry. But I felt of it, and I felt something hard inside, so I ripped it open, and there was a CD inside by Joni Lamb, and the title of it was God's Faithful. And my human reasoning again kicked in, and I'm thinking, oh, I know what this is. This is one of those promotional deals. They just send you a CD, try to get you hooked into their ministry, and you know, and then they'll never leave you alone. And so, but while I was fudging around, there was an envelope in there. And I looked at that envelope, and I mean, man, it was glossy. It had raised lettering. I mean, it was an executive letterhead, you know. And I opened it up. And I'll just kind of paraphrase what it said. It says, Dear Brother Bassemier, on the behalf of Marcus and Joni Lamb and Daystar Ministry, we've closed a check enclosed a check for $1,000 for your ministry. And I'm holding this $1,000 check. Now think, who are these people? How did they get my name? Rather than thanking God for his grace, I'm trying to figure all this stuff out. And so I went to work the next day, and a minister friend of mine called me and said, what's going on? I said, man, you ain't going to believe what happened, bro. I got $1,000 from Dayton. I don't know how to. He said, man, when was it written? And I said, I don't know. So I went back home and got the photocopy of the check, because I didn't put that thing in the bank. So I had a photocopy. And it had January the 8th, I believe it was 2000. January the 8th. Well, I got to looking at the checkbook, and it was January the 8th that I paid my phone bill, and I went to Walmart and bought those groceries. And when I stepped out by faith and trusted in the sufficiency of God's grace, God spoke to someone in Dallas, Texas on January the 8th, and they wrote that check. And I got it on January the 9th. Figure that one out. And guess what? Not only did I get the $1,000, I got the $1,200 that I had from painting the house. And so I had $2,200 coming to my hands within a 4-day period of time, and I never had a check bounce. And let me say this in closing. God told me, he said, you have a family in my kingdom that you don't know about. We got family, church, scattered all over the world. And if God spoke to somebody in Spokane, Washington, to send you a blessing, he can do that. But until then, what do we do? What do we do in our time of need? My grace is sufficient for thee.
Well, you can try to call these people.
I tried several times to call. Yeah, I did. I tried several to find out. And every time a phone would disconnect or nobody would answer the phone. So to this day, and this has been 18 years ago. There about, 2000, so 16 years ago. And I still don't know how they got my name. But that's irrelevant. God sufficiently grace provided. And so where you're at right now, what you're going through, just trust in the all-sufficiency of God. God's bigger than our problem. He's greater than our need. And there ain't nothing. He said, I've never seen the righteous forsaken or their seed begging for bread. If we'll leave it alone and quit trying to figure it out and make something happen, God's gonna provide. I believe, let me say this, I believe, and I'm saying this publicly, that God's gonna send somebody to this church to give a substantial amount of money to this church. I believe that's gonna happen. Why? Because we're trusting in the grace of God.
Amen. Amen.
And I'm going to pray every day, praising Him, worshiping, thanking Him. And God's going to do it. Why? Because His Word said, I'll make a way where there seemeth to be no way. Ask and you shall receive. This ain't word of faith. This is the Word of God. Trusting in all sufficient. In my weakness, He's made perfect. So, any questions or comments? Brother Larry?
Yeah. But, grace is something that, it's sufficient for us, not only at salvation, but throughout our life. But sometimes we buy where we can't afford to buy.
Sure.
Instead of going and, buy something that's economy, that's within reason.
Yeah.
I had a lady one time, she said, you ought to go shop where I shop. I said, well, if I go shop where you shop, I would impress people. Yeah. With my clothes. But I said, God would not be impressed with me going there.
Why would I go to Brothers and pay $95 for a pullover polo shirt when I can go to JCPenney's and get it for $15?
That's it.
Just because it comes from Brothers?
If you're a good steward, you're being a good steward.
Y'all
Walmart,
I'm
bro.
Going to dirt cheap.
That's it. It's stewardship. It's stewardship.
DD discount.
There's nothing wrong in being
DD discount. That's good.
And being good stewards.
No.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Garage sale. You can find stuff at garage sale.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely.
I went to
Brother Lance, you got something to say?
Yeah, I was thinking about what you were saying earlier, and it brought me back to a time also where in September when we got back from California, how I went, months without a job. And
y'all don't go in the sound room.
I had that same thing going on where I was filling out application after application. But I remember a lot of times sitting down with this man of God here, and he would say, Brother Lance, use this time for the Lord. Use this time for the Lord. You can't fight your way out of this situation. You can't manipulate it and all this stuff. And I took that advice, and I took that time of being with not being able to provide for my family by my own hands. And as I began to seek the Lord and just enjoy His presence and seeking His face, God was providing those things that my little natural hand couldn't provide. And I was thinking that that's grace. And 2 Peter chapter 1, based off of everything that's been said, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ our Lord. According to his divine power, he had given us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who had called us to glory and virtue.
That's right. That's a good word.
That's awesome, a good word. Right there.
Mm-hmm.
So, trust it. Quit trying to figure it out.
Brother Larry. Brother, you can bankrupt yourself helping somebody that is going through a test from God.
That's right.
And that test is going to drain you before it eventually will get to him.
I've seen it happen, Brother Larry. 30 years of ministry, I've seen it happen over and over and over. And I've been participant of it, so I know. And I think that I'm doing a good thing.
That's right.
You know, helping somebody out. But at the time, and nobody was teaching me this, so I'm having to learn it on my own. And I'm being reprimanded because I'm trying to do a good thing, but I'm doing it the wrong way.
Mm-hmm.
And so God's trying to help this person in a test to teach them something they've got to know.
That's it.
And I'm seeing it because it's family or a friend or whatever. And we want to go and help that person by doing a good thing, and all we're doing is adding to the harm of it.
Yeah. Prolonging
the test that they need to.
See,
that's why I went through what Brother Lynn said. I went through a time where I put in 35, 40 applications with not one phone call.
That's it.
Not one phone call. McDonald's wasn't even calling.
But we, right now, at this point in time, our house in Amy needs a new roof. They said, we're going to cancel your insurance. It was canceled the 22nd of this month.
Canceled Wednesday
I
night.
I told him, I said, we are not going to borrow the money.
Nope.
We could go borrow it. I mean, there's people that would lend us the money. I said, this is God's business. This is God's house.
Amen.
And I said, if he wants a roof on it, he'll put it on it. I said, if he wants to blow it down, he'll blow it down. But I said, God is working something out here. And we're going to let him do it.
Amen.
And
Amen.
When God gets ready for a roof to be put on it, he'll put a roof on it.
Hallelujah.
If he don't, he'll blow it down, and somehow or another, somebody will give us something else.
That's it.
So I'm not worried about it. But our insurance is canceled, but we're going to wait on God.
Well, that's just it.
You have what?
You got a parsonage. You know, so, but think about it, churches. The grace of God wants to carry us through our weakness. And he wants to be our strength. He wants to be our very present help in a time of trouble. I sleep it sound at night. I'm serious, church. I have such peace. I don't worry about nothing anymore. That's why I snore so much. I'm out there.
Amen. Sister says she's not sleeping real sound, though.
Hey, Mike, turn over on your back.
Now that mask in me, I don't want that mask on my face.
That's what you gave him. That'll stop all that sneering.
I was thinking about that, Pat.
The man called me and saw me my vehicle was ready today. He said, you want me to charge tax on that? I said, yes, sir. Now, I could have went along with him and just cheat the government. But brother, my testimony before him would have been a thief.
Yep.
You know, you're stealing from the government.
Yep. That's right.
So I said, put it on there. So it cost me $44 more.
Yeah, well,
but I said,
but you can sleep sound at night.
Amen.
He looks at me and he respects me.
Yeah. Yeah. That's right.
You'd be surprised how people are looking at
that's
you
right.
and see you're doing something that's off color.
You're conscious.
Yeah.
Amen. Well, let's stand together.
I'll say this last thing, Pastor. They train lifeguards not to jump in the water and save anybody
until
all
their
strength is out. Yep. Yep.
Let's pray. Father God, thank you for the word tonight.
Thank
you, God, the receptive of it. We ask you, God, to give each and one traveling grace and mercy. God, your provisions is already being provided for, God. I thank you for your grace that is sufficient. Lord God, that your strength is made perfect in my weakness, Lord God, that you're always here, that you're always, Lord God, watching over us. We ask, thank you for this night. We pray for the service Sunday, Father God, that all the festivities of the fellowship, Lord God, and we just give you honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
God bless you. Hug somebody's neck. Amen. Let them know how much love.
I'm still stuck on $1,000. Because how'd he got your name? How'd
he
got your address?
Yeah,
yeah. Your name is one thing, but your address.
Seriously, I don't know how they got it.
That's what I'm saying.